So, in order for us to prepare mentally, spiritually, we're going to listen to perhaps one of the most beautiful poems received by the composer Beethoven. In another lecture, I talk about music and mediumship and how so many of the composers were mediums themselves. And it was no different with Beethoven, especially with this piece called Choral Fantasy. He woke up in the middle of the night and he felt really inspired, and he fervently began to write down a few poems, and of which is really an exaltation, a glorification, a way to praise God. And he was so unsure of what he had received because it was in such a hurry that he sent it to his publisher saying, look, this is what I wrote, I'm not sure. You know, he was very insecure, but he wrote beautiful music to go along with it. It was premiered in 1808 in Austria, and it's for piano and orchestra and a chorus. We're just gonna hear the very end of it, and as we hear it, I have put the lyrics that are in German, I put it in Portuguese and English. As you hear the lyrics and as you hear the music, the idea is for us to really connect as a form of prayer so we can all elevate the vibration together. So,
thank you.
All right. Thank you. What'd you guys think? Pretty cool, right? And it's not a very well-known piece by Beethoven. So, let us jump right in to the first part, which is a dialogue with you guys. Let's get the conversation going. Who would like to volunteer? What is prayer? A conversation with God. Sincere feeling that comes from your heart. Good. Yes. Anybody else want to volunteer for the number one, or should we move to number two? Conversation with God is a sincere feeling from the heart. Exchange of thoughts between you and the spirits. Exchange. So there's an interaction.
Yeah, there is.
Okay. Let's see. We're going to examine that later. Good. Okay. Why should we pray? To be close with higher vibrations. Let's remember these answers because they're going to come in very handy later on. To be closer with higher vibration. You guys have to speak up.
Everything around us and also ourselves in a good hour vibration.
Maintain.
Maintain.
So that's another key word here. To maintain our vibrations high, right? Anybody else? To be thankful. So why should we pray? So we can be thankful, right, for what we've got?
And also
ask for help.
Ask for help.
Okay. So for to be thankful, to ask for help. The directors can speak too. They don't have to be shy, you know. You guys can speak up too. Hey, TJ.
How are you?
Good. So I guess we've exhausted number two. All right. So how does it affect the individual?
In a positive way.
In a positive way? How? Elevates our vibrations. Let's remember these keywords. Elevates our vibrations, connects us with our spirit guides, okay?
Brings us back to harmony.
Brings us back to harmony, right? Anybody else for number three?
Sense of peace when you genuinely pray from your heart. Not like this praying, but
genuine feeling of peace when you really pray from your heart, right?
And I think also to fulfill us with hope and faith.
So it strengthens our faith and our hope, right? Oh, how do we think it affects the community?
In a huge way.
In a huge way. You guys can all hear him?
More positive forces by prayer, the community will be more at peace and more cohesive.
Yes, exactly. It affects the community in a very positive way. So it's a way to send energies, right, to the community. It also affects the community how? This is great. Whoever is prepared to receive, let's remember that keyword. Whoever is prepared to receive, receives, right?
The
one that is open, right? Right.
To reconnect their whole with God.
To reconnect with God.
The whole.
The environment, right? Balances the environment. That's right. Cleanses, right? How many kinds of prayers are there?
Several.
Several. such as? I think we've kind of gone over it a little bit already, but.
Some people read.
You never read anything to pray.
No, I think in them, I send the words out there.
Okay.
Some people just stay in silence.
Cool.
Try to, can we say that meditation?
Meditation is a form of prayer. Would you guys agree with that?
Mm-hmm.
Right? Yes? Definitely? Klebe? Horizontal prayers?
That's the one you just repeat the words, like in your eyes, and there's no feeling attached to it. Vertical prayer, when you really connect to the real, the high realm. And downwards prayer, that's when it's invocation, when you invocate like spirits, or that's in a negative sense, invocation.
Very good, Kleber. Thank you. You've been extremely helpful to my lecture because you talked about something we're going to address precisely. Horizontal, vertical prayers and downwards as evocation prayers, right? So you mentioned some types of prayers and components within each prayer, right? Yes. And then we're going to look at the objectives of prayers, but these are some types of prayers. And then before we move on, there's just one more point to address is prayers in foreign languages. Because the spirits in the Gospel According to Spiritism on chapter 28 in the preamble, they want to make a specific point about prayers being intelligible. So they say, according to St. Paul, one essential condition for prayer is that it must be intelligible so that it may speak to our spirit. Thus, it is not for it to be uttered in language understood only by the one who prays. So like those masses in Latin, if the people sitting there, person doesn't understand Latin, they may not be able to necessarily connect with what the speaker is saying, or Sanskrit, or Hebrew. As long as you understand the words and they have meaning in your heart, is valid. But to just say prayers in a dead language or an old language, if you don't understand what they mean, they won't have an extra mystical effect. All right, so great conversation. Let's remember these answers, all right? They were really, really good. Let's start then by looking at the root word of prayer. In Latin, orare, to speak, and also precare, which means to preach, to request, to beg. So these are the roots of the word prayer from Latin. An essential condition to prayer we see in all of the books, in all religions, not just in the books that we read in Spiritism, but in Hinduism, Judaism, Buddhism, Sikh religions, Islam, Christianity, all of them uniformly say that an essential condition to an effective prayer is the attitude of humility. So let's examine where humility comes from. Humilitas or humilis, humble, but, and here's the key, means grounded, from the earth, soil, since it derives from humus. So let's look at humus. Other than Mediterranean restaurants, where do we find humus, right? Where does the word come from? It has its roots in Greek, Sanskrit, Indo-European dialects, and all kinds of ancient languages. The word humus goes back all the way to ancient Egypt. Now, the scientific definition of humus, other than that delicious paste, is a natural organic compounds that are found in the soil formed from the chemical and biological decomposition of plant and animal residues and from the synthetic activity of microorganisms. So from that, what do we get an idea of when we read that, of what humus could be? That humus. What word comes to mind? It's a very fertile soil. It's abundant in all of these energies, right? And if it weren't for the floods in the Nile River, Egypt would not even be on the map as a civilization. It's only because of the floods of the Nile River that once the waters receded, it left behind miles and miles of humus that the civilization of Egypt was able to even exist, because all of their nourishments and agriculture was thanks to humus. So the great analogy here that nature provides us is that humus is a very fertile and abundant soil. So if our attitude of our spirit is one of humility, we're going to be acting like the humus, where this soil is going to be germinating, was going to be abundant when we really prepare ourselves with that attitude in mind when we start praying, right? And is confirmed by the Spirit's book in question 658. A prayer is always pleasing to God, and I'm italicizing these words myself so that we can make a comparison to scientific explanations later, okay? Prayer is always pleasing to God when spoken from the heart, for intent is everything to God. Do not believe, however, that God is touched by the prayer of vain, proud, or selfish people, unless their prayer represents an act of sincere repentance and true humility. So, what do you guys make of this? These words here, pleasing to God and touched by the prayer? Connection, right? You think God is unpleased or upset at any moment? Is there anyone here in this room who still believe that God is a vengeful God or is temperamental, bipolar, like us imperfect human beings? Right? That he won't be touched by your prayer? No, right? We're talking about connection. We're talking about a scientific principle that's underlying the Spirit's explanations here. So let's examine that a little more. We've identified some prayers. Now let's see the goals. According to the Spirit's book in question 659, there are three main goals of prayers: to praise, to thank, and to ask. Who wants to read this for us? Valeria? Okay, Yara, then Valeria. Just speak up, please.
You want to read the whole thing?
Yes.
Okay. The main requirement of a prayer is that it be clear, simple, and concise, without needless phraseology or an excess of epithets that are merely shown final. Each word should be important, reveal a thought, and strike a chord. In short, it should cause one to reflect otherwise. It is just noise.
Thank you. That's from the Gospel According to Spiritism, chapter 28, the preamble to the prayers.
Epithets.
Yes. Thank you, Adam. You guys are falling right into my traps. This is great. Epithets. Who knows what an epithet is? Kind of. Epithets are attributes given to names. So Zeus, the Greek Olympian god, that's an epithet for Zeus. Sometimes we find ourselves doing prayers where instead of focusing on thanking, asking, and praising, we go beyond and we start with phraseology and epithets. Some examples: oh, dearly divine beloved Jesus Christ, our elderly brother who is so beautiful and great, right? Even though it may come from your feelings and your heart, do they need that in a prayer? I mean, if you're doing it on your own, right? If your prayer is by yourself, there is no rules to this. If it comes from the heart, it's valid. But I'm talking now in the case of prayers when we're doing prayers in public. If we start going on, veering off into this, we start disconnecting a little bit, getting some interference, distracting people. So that's what epithet means. Merely showy finery. We want to show that. Now, any hint of sort of this worship that still we bring from other reincarnations in a dogmatic way, perhaps this is something that's coming across. We're doing all of this worship to a personality or to a saint or something, and we start attributing so much importance to the figure as opposed to the actual intent of the, or the thought behind the prayer, right? Each word should be important, reveal a thought, and strike a chord. That's really important. Strike a chord really means affinity, energetic vibrational affinity. Cause one to reflect. Otherwise, it's just noise. Let's remember the word noise, because they really, the spirits were writing this through the mediums that were assisting Kardec in the mid-19th century, and it was during the time that electricity, electromagnetic phenomena, mesmerism, hypnotism started to be discovered. So these started to become part of the terminology of science. It's very important. Any questions here? So let's jump to the studies. Now, if you Google today, efficacy of prayer, the power of prayer, religion studies, spirituality, Google is going to give you a list of hundreds of thousands of studies, of articles, of journals, of research. We don't have all day here, so I had to pick a couple. I picked two. One that talks specifically about spirituality and religiosity and the impact of our health. And the second one regarding prayers to people that we know specifically, all right? So this one is really not a study, but a comprehensive compilation of 20 years of scientific data from 1990 to 2010, which was just published this year by two doctors, Dr. Harold Koenig from Duke University, in association with Dr. Raphael Bonelli from the University of Vienna in Austria. What they basically did is they compiled a systematic evidence-based review of the available data in the field of psychiatry, which has not been done in the last 20 years. We examined original research on religion, religiosity, spirituality, and related terms published in the top 25% of psychiatry and neurology journals, according to the International Science Institute Journals Citation Index 2010. So what does that mean? That they only picked from the top 25% of studies that were most often cited by other studies. This is one way of providing credence and credibility to a specific report. So they only picked the top 25% of those. And out of the 43 publications that met these criteria, that had religion, religiosity, spirituality, and related terms, 72% found a relationship between level of religious spiritual involvement and less mental disorder. So the short conclusion is, spirituality, religiosity, or involvement in these things produces better health. Mental health, physical health, right? Very powerful finding over here. And then the next study was just concluded this year at Florida State University, where the researchers gathered several dozens of couples, romantic couples, and also groups of very close friends, and they instructed them to pray for one another in specific moments, or, this was one group, or just think about God. They wanted to create a distinction between prayers as an active, participating activity that a person does with engagement, with intention, versus just a open suggestion of think about God, right? These are amazing findings here. Four findings that they saw. Participants who prayed more frequently for their partner were rated as less vengeful in discussing something the partner had done to upset or annoy them. Anybody relate to that? Yeah, right? The partners of participants who prayed for them noticed more forgiving behavior than the partner of participants who were assigned to set aside time each day to think positive thoughts about them. You see what the study is trying to distinguish, right? Forgiving behavior. That's a big one, right? Third, participants assigned to pray following a partner's hurtful behavior were more cooperative with their partners compared to participants assigned to engage in thinking about God. So the attitudes of those people. Their reactions, even if they were not aware of it, was changing, automatically changing. And lastly, participants who prayed for a close relationship partner on days in which conflict occurred, which in my house is every day, reported higher levels of cooperative tendencies and forgiveness than on days when conflict occurred and they did not pray. So on the science is there, the evidence is irrefutable that the active attitude of prayer actually causes forgiving behavior and allows us to become better as people. And then the Spirit's book actually confirms that in question 666. Who would like to read that for us? Valeria.
Does prayer make people better? Yes, because those who pray fervently and confidently strengthen themselves against the temptations of evil. And God sends the good spirits to assist them. Such help is never refused when sincerely asked for.
Thank you. It's what AJ brought from the heart, sincerely, right? And it's very important for us to meditate on this answer, because we're going to move into a topic of science and unanswered prayers having to do with science. But before we go there, let's emphasize this. Such help is never refused when sincerely asked for. Confidently strengthen themselves against the temptations of evil, and God sends them good spirits to assist them. So we pray fervently and sincerely. Our prayer will never be left unanswered, correct? So we connect immediately to God. But who does the will of God? Who actually does the will of God? Who actually performs the will of God?
We do.
Yes, we do.
Through us,
but it's right here. Right. So the co-creators of God, those spirits that are already highly evolved, have already cleansed and purified themselves, are co-creators. They're the ones that hear our prayers. And if God approves of it and says, green light, go ahead, the spirits execute it. They help us. They bring it to our vibrational level. So let's go to the science of it. The following slides I got from a study by Carlos Torres Pastorino in a book called Técnicas da Mediunidade, or Techniques of Mediumship. Unfortunately, this book has not yet been translated to English, but it's a phenomenal and very simple and easy to understand book about how mediumship works. And he makes all of these comparisons with electricity, electromagnetic fluids, and how it works, including prayer. So all of this information is taken from this material. So, does anybody need a break to stretch or to yawn? Because we're going to get into a lot of definitions here. Nobody falling asleep yet? Good. It's the AC. Thank you, AC. Let's start with the first one, waves. Waves are the movement of the vibration of particles in a current. So everything in the universe is never still. Everything is vibrating. There are particles everywhere and they're always vibrating. So the movement of those particles is done through waves in a current. Current or corrente in Portuguese. Frequency of waves or thoughts, there are two, right? High frequency waves are their force derives the wave's vertical oscillation, and the horizontal length of those high frequency waves, they're very short, so they're very fast, okay? Horizontal meaning length of time. Low frequency waves, they have a weaker or smaller vertical isolation or amplitude. The horizontal length is very long, so they're long, and their amplitude, their valleys and their peaks, are very small. High frequency waves, high amplitude. Now, what's key here is that what causes the high amplitude or the vertical oscillation is the force of those waves. Let's remember that, the strength of those waves, because we're going to make an analogy to us as spirits and what propels those energies, right? Okay. According to Pastorino, he says, how can human beings elevate the frequency of a wave, of a thought, to a higher vibration? And he's clear, it's two words, unconditional love. It's important that he puts the word unconditional before. Why is that? There's no condition. There's no expectation of a bargain, right? Unconditional love. And everything that's contrary to love reduces the thought's vibration frequency, like resentment, bitterness, sadness, apathy, indifference, selfishness, vanity, or anything that expresses separation and isolation. And 2,000 years ago, we have the scientific explanation in the gospel. Mark 11:25. And when you stand praying, if you hold anything against anyone, forgive them, so that your Father in heaven may forgive you for your sins. Do we think a prayer is going to have a lot of effect if while we're praying, we've got all of these bitterness and resentments and anger and hatred towards other people? First of all, it must be very hard to concentrate. It may be very distracting, right? But as far as vibration frequencies, according to this study, are we vibrating from a place of unconditional love if in the background all of this noise is happening? Probably not, right? Our waves are not going to be very high. Now, last slide on him. The thought currents, like electrical currents, our thought currents can be one of two ways. They can be direct currents, which is the intensity and direction of the current does not change from point A to point B. It is continuous. So meditation, yoga, all of the activities that help us silence our mind so we get into an altered state of consciousness, which science has already demonstrated that when we enter that state, our brain starts creating new waves called delta waves and alpha waves, which are very actually good for our immune system. That's the ability to stay firm, focused, concentrated. That's the direct. And then alternating is when the intensity and direction vary, which is not a bad thing. This is just two different kinds of thought currents. When we emit and receive thoughts in alternation. We send a thought and then we receive the response, because everything goes from point A to point B in a closed current, in a closed circuit. That's how electricity works. It goes in one direction, positive, from point A to point B, and it goes in a negative direction from point B to point A. The prayers and the thoughts are the same way. The positive thoughts are high vibration frequencies and short wavelengths. And then the low thoughts, the lower thoughts, are low vibration frequency and long wavelengths. Questions? Okay. I will take your silence. Okay, thank you.
When in distress,
thank you, Abilio. I didn't show him the lecture before, but this is a great question. When we are in distress, where we are emotionally disturbed, right? How do you think our brain is emitting waves? They are in high frequency, all right, but they're not direct. They don't stay continuous. They're spurts, they're bursts. And you're going to see in electricity the equivalent to that. So, when we apply the concepts of electricity to prayer, we have the direct wave is when we only send our thoughts and speak them to God. So, it's really not a complete prayer, because God also responds. And if we want to be open and receive, we have to vibrate in an alternating current. We don't want to teach God how he needs to help us. This God is, I want you to do, okay, I'm done, I'm going to go out. You disconnect and you don't hear a response, right? Whereas the alternating, we send thoughts, but then we silence ourselves to hear the silent response in our heart, which is where God dwells, right? How far up can a prayer reach and how effective can it be? Depends on the instrument's ability to emit an uninterrupted and strong, heartfelt current of waves, as opposed to emitting just damped waves, which is what Abilio just raised. Who's heard of damped waves? Any scientists in the house? Any students of electricity? I'm not one. I had to research all this stuff, and it's very complicated stuff. So, damped waves, or sometimes could be unanswered prayers, they're the ones where people are sending them in a way that their brains are not accustomed to the habit of prayer or to the habit of silencing themselves vibrationally in order to connect with God. So if they're in a situation of distress, they're going to pray and they're going to speak fervently and they're going to create all of these spurts of sparks of light, which is light, but then those waves die down. So the definition is a damped wave is a wave whose amplitude of oscillation decreases with time, eventually going to zero. Its effects, or the sparks, generate electrical noise. Remember earlier the spirit saying that unintelligible or repetitive prayers, they just produce noise? Electromagnetic interference, which interferes with other radio communications. Who can tell me what this is? Who's old enough to tell me what this is? A telegraph, a Morse code telegraph. Código Morse, telégrafo. You're very young, you're not gonna remember. Morse code telegraph. So a telegraph was the very first invention of electricity that was able to send damped waves across radio communications. Now, these damped waves, they created these sparks. When you see in the movies, if anybody has seen the movie Titanic, you see the shot where they're showing the Morse code, you see sparks. Every time he touches the two magnets, it creates a spark. That's what damped waves were. But today, the convention of all radio communications has banned this type of frequency, which they call Class B emissions, because they cause a lot of interference, right? So all of these things from the field of electricity can so easily be transported to the field of prayer and the field of affinity, right? In a very complex and scientific way in 2013, we are seeing what Jesus said in very simple terms 2,000 years ago. Pray and be vigilant, right? Why pray and be vigilant? As we pray more, our brain becomes more accustomed with that habit, therefore able to do less and less damped waves and more able to emit direct waves, therefore connecting to higher vibrations. And also, by being vigilant, we protect ourselves from other people's damped waves. Because most of the energies and thoughts that are being sent by spirits who are not harmonious or balanced, they are damped waves. They cause noise. They cause electromagnetic interference, literally. A way to protect our brain from attuning to that is by praying and being vigilant, or practicing meditation, having a religiosity, having all of those exercises, right? Any questions?
So the amplitude of the wave has nothing to do with the distance that the prayer goes.
Yes and no, right? The force is what determines the amplitude. So the more heartfelt, the more fervent the prayer is, the more humble it is, the higher the amplitude. Therefore, the higher it can go. By higher, we mean we start thinking of a geographical or a temporal place, but really that's not how it works. It's only frequencies, only vibrational frequency. The higher the amplitude, it's the higher that the prayer will go. Yes. And faster.
But the smaller the waves, faster you want to align, so it's against
the distance. Yeah, it's only also distance and also time.
Yeah, that is also because we have, we tend to think of time and space, and they don't have time and space.
They have it in a different way that is not really applicable to matter, right? Adam.
Can you repeat that again? I think I finally get it why you say the vigilant. Protection against what?
So, like, when we have anybody that's in not a harmonious way, on a balanced way, both incarnate and discarnate, especially discarnate because we're not able to see them, right? Most of the time, their disturbance, their imbalance, is what that is emitting is in the form of damped waves. Either damped waves or very low frequency waves, right? Specifically damped waves, what do they cause in electromagnetic communications? Noise, interference. The same thing happens to us. So our brains and our spirits, the analogy can be of a radio. If a radio station is sending beautiful music at 105.9 dial, which is a classical music station, very good station, and that radio is attuned to 105.6, or 105.7, are you gonna hear the music?
Not as clear.
You may hear noise, you may hear static, but you're not gonna hear it as much. Now, we have the ability to control our dial and also restrict it to certain frequencies, right? We can stay in lower frequencies if we choose not to be vigilant, not to pray, just let matter and our old habits settle in and this is what I'm going to do. I'm not going to really make any vertical attempts, right? Then your radio transmitter here is going to be receiving all those lower energies. And therefore, also not able to very easily send out high vibrations, high frequency waves, because it's a matter of habit. Your dial is stuck in that frequency. So it will take much more effort, concentration, direct currents, all, in order for you to really go up and raise your vibration. Make sense?
Thank you.
Welcome.
Are you talking about for us to be really concentrated when we are praying, to be wanting? I don't know if that
works. So, have everybody hear her question?
No.
Could you repeat? What we're saying here is to be very concentrated.
For us to be at the right to, you know, to, like you said, as an example, for the radio, to listen to music properly. So for us to get this, we need to be really concentrated.
Correct. Correct. And everything in life is an exercise. The spirit also has its own muscles to flex, right? And the ability for us to get into a mode of concentration can be much easier if we have the practice, right? You'll see later on Christ's instructions on how to effectively pray, and we're going
to
talk about that.
Happened to me many times.
Right?
Sometimes until now, when I'm very worried about something, and I try to pray, and I start praying, and suddenly a thought came between, I need to restart.
Right. How many people have the same problem? Many times when I'm doing the Our Father prayer, which is so short, which I've been taught how to do since I was 2 years old, sometimes there's so much going on that by the third sentence I'm already thinking of work. Yeah. And I'm thinking of tomorrow and my mother and oh boy, let me start again. Right? Anybody else? Okay. Right. There it is. So after understanding all of these electrical phenomena and seeing how our brain behaves, let's look at Matthew 6, 5 through 15, which is the moment of Jesus' passage on earth, right before he gave us the instruction of the Our Father prayer. Right before the Our Father prayer, this is what he instructed. Who would like to read for us? Kleber.
When you pray, do not be like the hypocrites, for they love to pray standing in the synagogues and on the street corners to be seen by others. Truly, I tell you, they have received their reward in full. But when you pray, go into your room, close the door, and pray to your Father, who is unseen. Then your Father, who sees what is done in secret, will reward you. And when you pray, do not keep on babbling like pagans, for they kind they will be heard because of their many words. Do not be like them, for your Father knows what you need before you ask him. For if you forgive other people and they sin against you, your heavenly Father will also forgive you. But if you do not forgive others their sins, your Father will not forgive your sins.
I think we discussed this a little bit in the Tuesday meetings, right? We're talking about prayer. Pretty much this is the scientific equivalent of what was said 2,000 years ago, right? Love to pray standing in synagogues on the street corners to be seen by others. So right there, that person is thinking more of the exterior connection that they're getting as opposed to the interior connection, right? Truly, I tell you, they receive their reward in full. I mean, those people are moved by a genuine spirit. So they're already receiving rewards, compensations, a feeling of being connected with spirit. That's what they mean. But when you pray, go into your room. I'm not talking about a bedroom, right? We're talking about another room. Close the door, what Shayla was saying. Close the door and pray to your Father who's unseen. What is closing the door?
The outside world.
The outside world. Every external worry that we have in our lives, in the moment that we're going to pray and connect to God, we need to close the door and leave it outside the room.
That's a beautiful attitude that you need with that. Not saying that you know what you need, but allowing God to speak for yourself.
Exactly, exactly. That's the outcome of a humble prayer that's done in secret when you're behind closed doors in your room and you left everything outside of the room. Then your Father, who sees what is done in secret, will reward you. Again, is our Father or Mother or Creator or whatever we want to call the source of this entire universe as we know. Reward, punish, be vengeful, right? These are the terms that were used 2,000 years ago to a society that was accustomed to hearing that. But scientifically, it's not a matter of reward or not reward. It's a matter of affinity, of assimilation of energies, of connection, striking a chord, when they said earlier, that's what that means. If you truly connect in this way, automatically, from inside the silence of your heart, you're going to receive that reward, that spiritual reward, which is inner peace that you mentioned, that fulfillment, that intuitive understanding that I know what I need to happen. I have received the answers that I needed. Even if they are not concrete outcomes, just the feeling alone is that answer. Yes?
I think that picture that you have there is a reward, right? So, and you mentioned like earlier that God sends us boosters.
Right. Exactly. This is exactly an example of that. The spirits come to us because we connect. They don't necessarily geographically transport themselves there. We enter into the frequency that they are vibrating in, and it's like we're there with them, right?
They are unseen.
They are unseen, exactly. Then your Father will reward you. And when you pray, do not keep on babbling like pagans, for they think they will be heard because of their many words. This is just this going, and it's not connecting to this. Blah, blah, blah. You're creating just noise, literally just noise. Do not be like them, for your Father knows what you need before you ask Him. Now, that is amazing, right? Your Father knows what you need before you even ask Him. So, are there really any prayers that are unanswered from this point of view? No. Because before you even pray, God already knows what you need and what you're going to ask for. For if you forgive other people, and this is the key again about forgiveness, one of the most important points that they stress. For if you forgive other people when they sin against you, your Heavenly Father will also forgive you. Scientific affinity, electric affinity. You cannot get your Father to forgive you for your sins if you're not even able to connect with your Father to begin with, because you are so full of energies and noises around you. You won't be able to connect. If you connect, that means you have forgiven. And if you have forgiven, then automatically the Father will also forgive you. But if you do not forgive others, Father will not forgive you for your sins, right?
I just want to say something that
I Yes?
So, to the point that your Father knows what you need before you ask Him, yes, He does. But it is also important to bring the humility that you show the right? He wants us to be humble, and that's why it is important that we ask.
Exactly. 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 The act of asking alone is halfway towards humility, because you start acknowledging that you are not an all-powerful being that does not need some help from the outside. We are gods. Jesus said that. You are gods. He was basically reiterating what David said in one of his Psalms. You are gods. Yes, we are co-creators. But to be a co-creator, you need to understand even that God exists. I mean, you need to start from an elementary level. And it all begins with opening up those compartments in your heart. And humility really helps to do that. The hummus analogy, I think, is so beautiful. There's no more fertile soil that is so abundant. It's so prolific, it blossoms, it germinates, then that hummus. And the same root word for humility is hummus. I think this is great, because it also complements the parable of the sower, for instance, that we discuss. The seeds land on fertile soil, they germinate 100-fold. If it lands on hummus, very fertile, on humility, on humble soil, right? Okay, how are we doing on time? We're good? Okay, prayer pitfalls. This is gonna be good. How many of you have heard of the explanation prayer?
Explanation prayer?
A mini a historinha, começa a contar a historinha. Remember? Yes. So we all have done it at one point or another. And of the pitfalls that I'm talking about here, they have more to do with prayers in group. So for our specific case here in the Spirit Center, in our public meetings, these are some of the pitfalls that we should avoid. The explanation prayer. So prayer has to have an idea. We have to thank in prayer, we should ask, and we should praise. Those are the three main components, right? They don't have to all be there, but you should address at least one of them in a valid prayer. But an explanation, a mini lecture in there, is really not necessary. So, who can give me an example of an explanation prayer?
I need this, because,
right.
Right.
So, not in this Spiritist Center, but in every Spiritist Center, and I'm sure in every religious institution we have, where we start, dear God. Okay. Invocation. I'm connecting with God. We are so thankful for everything that we give in our lives. We thank. We like to glorify, we love you for everything that we have in our life. Okay, they're praising. We'd like to ask you to strengthen us and to forgive us and to give us what we need in order to overcome our difficulties. Okay. Because we know, God, that we are imperfect beings, and we know that out there with the laws of reincarnation, we know that in those moments of life, and we know, and because of this, and we start giving out concepts and doctrines and explanations and it goes and goes and goes, and the active component of the prayer starts going down. We start disconnecting. Right? Anybody with me here? Yeah. Do you guys agree or am I not? Okay, we've all experienced it, right? So I'm saying this to myself too because I'm very guilty of it and I've done it many times, but for all of us here that are involved and committed to being practitioners, when we are entrusted with doing a prayer, let's remember the objectives of the prayer are to thank, to ask, to praise, empower ourselves, you know, validate our faith. Those are the core ideas. To start, and there's nothing wrong with sending energies to different places, sending vibrations, because this is very proactive. But when we start doing conceptualizing, and because we know that we are immortal souls, and we know that in our previous lives, we've gone to so many passages on earth and the journeys, and okay, you may be moved by a very genuine feeling. But if you're doing these prayers in public, you may lose a lot of the people that are trying to follow you. Because you start losing the focus, right?
That's the reason I don't sit in the front row, because I was in a spirit center once, and the person was doing the final prayer, you keep saying because, and somebody pushed me, said, wrap it up.
What? What do we say?
Wrap it up.
Wrap it up.
Just to say, wrap it up. And then he looked at me, and I said, and then he keep going. Well, I never stand in the front row.
Wrap it up.
I'm a bit confused, but that's what I wasn't going to.
That's also kind of repetitive prayer. So we're there, we feel like we need to fill up 2 or 3 minutes of time because it's a final prayer or something. So if we're losing inspiration or we start running out of words, we start repeating the same words again. Don't have to. It's more important to have the quality of prayer from the heart than the quantity of thoughts, right? Distracted prayer is more for private cases, which we just talked about already. I'm there, I'm praying, I'm locked into my room, I left everything outside, but then it starts coming in through the windows. It starts coming in my job, and before I know it, I'm distracted. So those are all damped waves, all forms of damped waves. So a quick analysis of the Our Father prayer. Now, that's important for those of us here, incarnate and also discarnate, that may be listening, that if they are not accustomed to the habit of prayer, any of us here, a great way to start is the Our Father prayer, primarily because it's very likely that they've heard it before or they were taught in school. And even if they don't know the profound meanings of it, they were just reciting it in a mechanical way, is a great starting point to connect, vibrationally speaking. And the spirits that wrote through Kardec's The Codification, they unanimously say, this is the main reference prayer to go to. It's a perfect synthesis of what Christ gave us, that sums up all of our needs that we have as immortal spirits temporarily in a physical body. It encompasses everything. So let's quickly examine it, right? Every word of this prayer has profound meaning, profound symbolism, and profound beauty. Our Father. So right there, we start. It's not me. It's not the ego. It's our. We're all brothers and sisters. Children of the same Creator, our Father. And Christ in this moment didn't attribute it Father. He didn't say Creator or God or Master of the Universe, Architect. He said Father. Something so affectionate, so beautiful, so tender. And he said only Father because Christ was Jewish. living 2,000 years ago in a deeply patriarchal society. Christ never intended to establish a new religion, ever. He was born Jewish, he was raised Jewish, he died as a Jewish man, and as a Jewish person, he followed the format of the Jewish prayers. But we can very easily add mother, our mother father. And our dear friend Eduardo, actually here in the spirit, in the inner enlightenment, used to do prayers like that. Dear God, our mother father, right? Because some people are more comfortable with thinking about God as a female mother figure as opposed to a male father figure. So, our Father, of all of us, who art in heaven. So, where is heaven?
Out there.
Out there? Where else? Heaven? Huh?
I prefer out there. You even though I guess you can say there's a little line connecting.
Right. It's in here. Heaven is in here, according to Christ. Kingdom of heaven is inside of you. So, God is inside of us. He dwells in heaven. What does that mean? In our individuality, in the eternal spirit that we are, a divine spark, God is in there, is inside of us. Hallowed be thy name, or in Portuguese, sanctified, santificado seja o vosso nome. Hallowed be thy name. So, if he is our father, mother, collectively, he or she, or both, art in heaven, inside of us, dwells there, what does sanctified be thy name produces? What's the goal of sanctifying the name?
Praise.
To praise, right? Now, if we are divine children of God, we are an extension of that divine spark inside of us. If heaven is inside of us, how do we sanctify God's name?
That the light shines through us.
One way. Right? The hallowed be thy name is not a passive wish for something to happen out there. Hallowed be thy name out there. No. Let us sanctify the name of the Father through our actions, through our thoughts, through whatever comes out of our mouths, through our deeds. That's how we sanctify God. Thy kingdom come. Kingdom, right? Very archaic visualization for us here in the 21st century of kingdom. We think of a king and a queen and the throne and the red. No, it's none of that, right? The kingdom. What is the kingdom of God?
Virtues.
Virtues. So the way we understand that is by a contrast. Where are we currently?
A
Spiritist center, okay. Where are we more existentially speaking currently?
Physical plane.
We're in a physical plane, right? The kingdom of God represents the spirit. We are spirits, but we're currently on earth. So we ask that the kingdom comes so that the spirit kingdom can dwell. And not the spirit of the opposite being matter and being Satan. Now, Satan is not the guy with the horns, right? Satan is the adversary, the oppositionist, the oppositor, as we say. So, that attaches to matter. Let the spirit kingdom come to us who are here in matter, so that it can overcome and overpower the kingdom of matter, right? Of Satan, if you will. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. It's pretty simple. That's pretty straightforward, right? We are eternal spirits. Eternal. We just didn't arrive here out of our own will, right? One day I was walking on the street. I had this epiphany. It was very simple, but at the same time, very profound. I was walking in New York with my iPod, going to the subway. It was in the morning, I was a little bit drowsy still, I was very tired, didn't have enough coffee, which was actually a good thing because I was more calm. And I'm like, wait a minute. If I'm living right now, it's because somebody wanted this. If I'm created, right, it's because somebody else wanted it. Like, whoa, I didn't create myself. I mean, it sounds kind of silly saying it, But I just had that epiphany, like, wow, I'm existing, I'm breathing, I'm here right now because somebody else willed that, right? So if that somebody else did that, was able to produce such a perfect body with livers and stomachs and brains that we don't even begin to understand how it works, and all of this beautiful planet, the universe, the stars, that person's will, I think, is a little wiser than our will, right? So it's an attitude of humility that we let the will of God be done as opposed to our will. And it's also a way to appease our souls if we're going through any harsh trials, to take a moment and have acceptance, resignation. Let your will be done. It's a way to show trust that we're trusting God. Not only on earth, the kingdom of matter, but also in the spirit kingdom inside of us, right? Give us this day our daily bread. The symbolism of bread doesn't necessarily have to stop at that nourishment that we eat every day. Christ said, we're going to earn our daily bread by the sweat of our brow. Also said that, and I lost my train of thought. Okay. Give us this day our daily bread. So this is, we're here currently incarnated. We need that nourishment. So we ask for it. The spirits say in one of the questions in prayer that heaven helps those who help themselves. And the spirit says, you already know this, right? So our daily bread is earned by our hard work. And we ask God, give us this day our daily bread. It's already a preparation that we're going to attune to God and we're going to do our part, but give us the daily bread. Forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. Electricity, connection, vibration. This is the key for us to stay connected to God, stay connected to higher vibrations. By forgiving our trespasses, we forgive those who trespass against us. We're asking God to forgive us for our trespasses so that we can connect to Him to begin with. Because we will have already forgiven those who trespass against us. It's just a way to get our radio transmitters in a higher vibration, to stay in that higher vibration, and not come down on lower vibrations of matter, right? And lead us not into temptation. Temptation, what is that? The weaknesses that we have, right? We're imperfect beings. We still have many temptations. So, however, we are spirits that are in the process of evolution, progress. That's something that's not going to change. That we have no control over. Progress, it's something that's inexorable. It's going to happen whether we want it or not. So we will face temptations because we need to go through it. But deliver us from evil. Let us not get stuck in matter. Let us not get matter overpower us. Let the spirit always triumph above it. So we will face our challenges because we need to overcome them. We need to transform that which is causing us to be tempted. We need to transform and sublimate. This is a law of energy. Energy is neither created or destroyed. It's always transformed. So we have to transform those temptations into virtues. But deliver us from evil, because we may let matter, the kingdom of matter, overpower us, and then that's what evil really means. Amen. Questions? So when we do the Our Father prayer next time, let us take a moment to go into our rooms, to lock our doors outside, disconnect from any external influences or our daily problems, and let's do the Our Father prayer slowly, because this time is eternal. Don't be in a hurry. You've got eternity, right? Really slow, and really think this through, and really let the words connect with your heart. And as we do that more and more, every time aware and conscious, we're going to start uncovering deeper and deeper layers of symbolism and profound understanding of this. This is like a code that we're just scraping the surface of understanding today.
And I think that's the peace with practice, not praying.
if we practice.
Now, every day, every minute of our life, you know, each line has what we do.
Right. Yeah.
So we just learn, so we just say, but we have to live.
Right. Exactly. This is just a reminder for us to reconnect with our divine essence, because we are incarnated. We are currently, temporarily, in a state of matter, material state, which by its own virtue is one that drives the energy down. That's the trajectory of energy in a material state. Condensed matter is downwards. It's precisely because of that dynamic that we are here, because our spirits need to exercise its muscles in order to break through that, right? The butterfly coming out of the chrysalis from the, is it a worm? What do they call it? The cocoon? That's the perfect analogy of going from a material state and from that through a lot of struggle, a lot of fighting the good fight. One day the cocoon breaks and a butterfly comes out, right? In a nutshell, that's the goal of our spiritual evolution. Yeah? Three words.
Yeah,
the three
words. Praise. Okay. Thanks.
Exactly. It's all contained here. So, because we've started with music, I think we should end with music. There's no better, for me, a great, Emmanuel says this through Chico Xavier. Whoever sings, prays twice. In the sense that when we're singing, and we're connected, it helps us to really put our heart into something, right? So we used a classical music example in the beginning. And some people have asked me in the past, well, is it only the classical music composers that are inspired? Isn't there like contemporary music that's inspired? Absolutely. So we're gonna get an example of that now. And the idea is that when we're done, we let that be sort of the ending to the meeting, and then whoever is in charge of doing the prayer, we can go straight to the passes. If you feel like singing, this is the moment to sing. Sing your heart out. Don't be afraid. Nobody else here. Marcelo is not going to film you, so you can just let your hair down and sing your heart out if you want. If not, you can do it in your head, but the idea is for the heart to be doing the talking here.
Do you have time for one question?
At the end. Let's afterwards, after the passes, anybody that has questions afterwards can talk to me and we can go back here or do the food and chat at the same time. But please hold your question. Don't forget. Please remember this song from 1990. Okay. So Michael Jackson wrote the lyrics himself, and this is just my personal opinion. I am a huge fan of Michael Jackson, and my personal intuition says that this was a very misunderstood soul that was divinely inspired for most of his life, had a mission, achieved that mission beautifully. And whatever other stuff was said about him and stuff is just, in my opinion, noise. That's my personal opinion that I'm expressing right now. And an example of his connection, his ability to really be a channel of inspiration, one of the best ones, in my opinion, is this song, Heal the World. So it really is a prayer through music.
And think if they can make it a better place.
There's a place in your heart, and I know that it is love. And this place is brighter than tomorrow.